morning. Good morning. Welcome to the Ventura Center for Spiritual Living. I'm Reverend Bonnie Rose. We're having a celebration of love this morning, love and kindness and all good things. Let's stand up and we'll sing together. And so it is, and so we allow it to be as we breathe deeply and move into that place of center, that place of love that moves through us always, that lives through us, as we relax, breathe, let go, and listen to the words of our sacred reading.
An excerpt from This Thing Called You by Ernest Holmes. You use the same power to drive your automobile forward or in reverse. The energy is not good when it moves you forward, nor evil when it moves you backwards. You must eliminate the idea of good and evil as entities opposing each other and realize there is but one life principle. There is but one electric energy wherever it is used. But one creative spirit where it is perceived. But one spiritual power wherever it is understood. This spiritual power must be without limit. Your thought and lack of acceptance of this power can put brakes on it. In this way, you limit the limitless. Well, you do not really limit it, but you do limit its flow into your own experience. The power which seemingly defeats you when you use it in a limited way gives you victory when you change your attitude towards it, permitting it to flow through you in a more extensive manner. You are never limited by the principle of your being. Limitation is a result of a limited use of this principle. There is something that honors your belief as you believe in it. Know that you exist in boundless good, a heavenly state, and perfect being. Know that divine law is here to guide you into peace, happiness, success, joy, love, and all-inclusive life. And so it is.
So let us breathe into an awareness of that all-inclusive life that is here for us to celebrate, for us to drive in forward or reverse. Whichever seems most appropriate, we allow the knowing of that life to fill us from the inside out and from the outside in. And we know that because there is only one life, as we recognize the life-filling force of all of this, the force and the source, we know that it is true for us, but we also know that it is true for all beings everywhere, that there is only one of us here, and that is the life of love expressing here in the appearance of duality. But the life of love is truly the wholeness that holds all appearances of duality. And so we move into non-dual awareness, into the recognition of wholeness, into the revelation of wholeness, absolutely knowing that we are whole, that we are inclusive, that we are complete, and that if it's true for us, it is true for everyone. We sing together, I am remembering who I am, knowing that I am is the name for love, spirit, higher power, the energy, the life force. And we sing it for ourselves as we sing it to bless all beings.
I am remembering who I am.
Centering into the remembrance of that which has never left us and never will leave us, the I Am presence, which is the truth of our existence. the truth of all existence. Let us anchor in that awareness and then breathe in deeply and exhale, opening our eyes in love and service to what is as it is. And so it is.
God's faithfulness has kept me, God's promises have blessed me, God's the one on whom I can depend.
I was really fascinated by the reading that Hugh did from our featured book this month, which is This Thing Called You by Ernest Holmes, where he talked about how driving forward is the same energy as driving back, and that driving forward is not good, and driving backwards is not evil. In my world, driving backwards is evil. Because some of you have may notice that I got a Prius, a beautiful plug-in Prius. It gets really great gas mileage. I wanted to lower my carbon footprint, and I've had it for 3 months, and in 3 months, I've had three accidents. All caused by the evil law of backing up. I have knocked off the passenger side mirror. I have taken out my husband's jade tree. I have scraped the side so that it required actual intervention, surgical intervention from a body shop. And this all happened in the confines of my own driveway. Clearly, I was used to my other car, which had a little bit better visibility, and this has one of those backup cameras that shrieks at you when you're backing up, and it's completely frustrating and disorienting, and I don't know what I'm doing, so I'm working on it. But I think the first step is to recognize that it is not the law of backing up and the law of physics and the law of auto mechanics that is at fault. It is my use of the law, my fragmented use of the law. Now, isn't that an interesting metaphor for many of us? Because sometimes when life is working, and you know, we don't really like the idea of blame here, it's not really about blame, but it's when life isn't working, we often are quick to place the blame outside of ourselves, to say that it's not working because of this external thing. If this was different, then I could be different. When really, here in this teaching, in the Science of Mind teaching, we say that the inner work comes first. We change the inner first. Knowing that law, any law, is just law, we change the inner first, and then we start seeing anew, and the outer changes. The quality of our inner experience affects the quality of our outer experience. Whether it changes literally or whether we just see it differently, the quality of our inner experience affects the quality of our outer experience. So that's what today is about. You know, a lot of us have been in this teaching for a while, and if you're very new to this, I'll explain a little bit about what we do here in just a moment. But a lot of us have been working with this thing that we call the law of cause and effect, and it feels like it should be working, but sometimes it feels like it isn't working. So we're looking at some of the subtleties of how we work with the law of cause and effect, and how we can change that so we can have a graceful and glorious life, not only for ourselves, but for all beings. This is not about blame. This is about empowerment. This is looking at how we can adjust things slightly. Just as I would look at the way adjusting how I back up from now on, we look at the ways we use laws and adjust them slightly to have a greater experience of this thing called life that is infinite, that is here for us, that is undeniably filled with grace, not only for us, but as we anchor in this, we can find grace for everyone. All right? Good with that? Anybody want a little more grace in their life? Okay. Grace is omnipresence. It's more about getting an experience of grace. So one of the things that I hear a lot about when I am teaching classes or even having casual conversations with people in the congregation is this idea of desire. Desire. Some folks feel that desire is not a good thing. You know, it's very similar to saying in the Buddhist tradition that suffering is caused by attachment. You might say that suffering is caused by desire. Some people might say that. I'm not sure that that's 100% correct, but some people might say that. I looked up bad quotes about desire, and I saw things like desire is enslavement. Desire creates false expectations of things that will not really make you happy. And so they asked me, is it bad to have desire? On the other hand, Napoleon Hill says that we are to cultivate a burning desire for what it is that we wish to experience in life. So how do we reconcile all of that? Well, some of you may have noticed or know all about the teaching symbol, which is that circle with the V, right? What does the V stand for? Ventura, yes. I've also heard it say that it stands for vulnerability, depending on the nature of the sermon, and also sometimes vortex, all right? It's a Ventura vortex of vulnerability, let's put it that way. But in Ernest Holmes's world, that V stands for something different. So let me talk about the V in a minute. The top layer is the layer of thought, or intention, or even desire, if you want to call it that. That moves into the middle layer. That's why the V is pointing down. The V is the movement of belief. It moves into the middle layer where it is absorbed by this creative matrix that we would call the law. It's like when you plant a seed, it goes into the soil, and the soil is this creative matrix. Now the soil has to take whatever seed it gets and create what the seed is giving it. And the same thing is true with law. If we are expressing thoughts of lack into that middle layer, then we will experience lack. The bottom layer is the world of form, the world of experience. This is how thought moves into form, how spirit becomes matter, how love becomes love, because it truly is all love becoming love. So we work with that symbol. And in that symbol, it seems that in the top layer, there, yes, there is a place for intention and for desire. Because Spirit is omnipresent. Spirit is omnipresent, infinite. It is also the void. And Spirit wants to express through each of us. And sometimes we have to give Spirit a container through which to express. All right, let's say you've got some beach toys. How's that? And you're at the beach and you have one of those pails that has like little starfish and little circles and little squares, and you can, and there's water in the pail, and you can pour the water into any of those shapes, right? And the water does not reject the shape that you give it. The water just goes into the shape that you give it. So our intentions are forming little containers for Spirit to pour into, that through which Spirit can express. So it's not like you're going to create a starfish and Spirit is going to say, ugh, not that, right? The water is going to go into the starfish. It's not going to assume the shape of a circle. It's going to assume the shape of a starfish. So that's what our intentions are. They are just providing containers through which Spirit can express. So Spirit knows what to do. You know, there are many, many, many teachings that say that Spirit created the world so that it might know itself through our experience, right? The Sufi tradition, I was a hidden treasure that longed to be known, so I created the world that I might know myself, right? So we're giving Spirit all of these containers through our intentions, through which it can express and which it can know itself, and it can experience church through the eyes of Reverend Bonnie, or it can experience gardening through Hugh, or it can experience financial work through Lacey, or music and working with Step Up Ventura through Mary. It's all of these things expressing through us. What happens sometimes, though, is that, yes, we are giving Spirit a container, and sometimes Spirit takes a while or a circuitous course to get there. And then we feel like Spirit is ignoring us, or the law's not working, or we must be doing something wrong, or we are unworthy. This happened to one of my relatives, my nephew's husband, a nephew in love, I suppose I would call him, because he's a good friend too. And he lives in New York, and he had a very sort of prestigious educational background, and he's a writer and a drama critic. And when he moved to New York, he had a career in mind. He had an intention, he had a desire, and his career needed to look like this. And I don't remember exactly what it was, but I'm going to assume he wanted to be a drama critic for the New York Times, right? It had to look like that. That was his intention. That was his desire. And he was setting that intention and doing the work around it and doing everything he thought he needed to do. In the meantime, he was getting a job over here, and then another job over here, and then another job over here. But there was the New York Times right there, and he couldn't get to it. He couldn't get to it. So this job over here felt like a failure because it wasn't the New York Times. And this job over here felt like it wasn't enough because it wasn't the New York Times. And this job over here said, wow, Mark, you must be unworthy because this is not the New York Times yet. So that's how we get in trouble with desires, is that we use them to define us. We don't have to be defined by desires. The world, it's not the world's job to define us. It is our job to define the world, to make meaning out of it and see what meaning we are applying to the world and then seeing if that meaning is true. Boy, I had such a great experience with defining and making meaning this past week. Many of you know that I'm in the process of cultivating a series of interviews that I'm doing with people that are, I'm calling reconciling angels, people that are doing the work of peace and healing and hope in the world. The first one I did was several weeks ago with Gina Walker, who spoke with us about her experience of racism. She's an African-American woman, and she spoke with us very eloquently about racism in America. And I'm working with somebody else now who has done work with reconciling Israelis and Palestinians in the Middle East. And I also am working with a woman who is a Christian minister who is a lesbian. And I want her to come and speak to the church. And she was reluctant at first, I think, because she didn't know who we were. But when I called her up, she said, well, what is exactly do you want from me? And I told her, you know, there are people in my church that will say, how can you be Christian and gay at the same time? Isn't that an oxymoron? And I'd be like, no, it's not. I know a lot of gay Christians, and it's delightful, you know? And so I wanted her to come and talk to us about her experience about being a gay Christian minister. We had such a great conversation, because she was talking about it, and she said that what's happening now is more and more churches are becoming open and affirming, right? Open and affirming means accepting of same-sex marriages and affirming that there are many, 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 many variations on the theme of sexuality and that they're all beloved by God or whatever it is you want to call it. As more and more churches are becoming open and affirming, they are discovering that, you know, there's this rumor that, okay, these people that are open and affirming and accepting of gay people, that they're reinventing the Bible. And my friend on the phone, Chris, said, you know, actually, that's not true. The people who put those constraints on gay people were reinventing the Bible. The original intention was inclusivity. And I thought that that was so beautiful. And I hung up the phone with her thinking about the generations and generations, thousands and thousands of years of people being defined by a literal translation of the Bible. People believing a falsehood that was pretending to be true. People believing a falsehood that was pretending to be true, and how that changed lives, and how that ruined lives, and how people not only used it to judge other people, but that the people that were in that position used it to judge themselves, and to somehow feel that they were unworthy because of this falsehood masquerading as the truth. And then to take it even farther, you know, I looked at, well, of course it's true, of course it's true. God, Spirit, love, whatever it is that created all of this is all about diversity and all about multiplicity. You know, I've been saying for the last couple of weeks, talking about infinity and diversity and multiplicity and all of this stuff, that, okay, when we look at the flowers, God did not just stop at a rose. God perhaps made the rose first and then said, okay, let's try daffodils, let's try pansies, let's try these flowers that nobody's ever seen before in the forests of Africa. You know, in music, too, God could have stopped at the piano, Chris. But how much fun would that have been, right? God created the piano and the drums and the sousaphone and the flugelhorn and all of these, the kazoo, all of these wonderful, wonderful, wonderful instruments that came through evolution, through this beautiful, beautiful urge in all of us to express in infinite forms. And why shouldn't that be true for sexuality? God made millions and millions of flowers. God made millions and millions of insects. There are billions of stars that don't look alike. And then God got to sexuality and said, oh, just one. Just one way to do that. And just one position while you're at it. Doesn't that sound just like God, right? Yeah, so my inspiration, my motivation, my encouragement for all of us is to move out of the missionary position in all things and to move into the visionary position. Did you like that? Was that clever or what? Yes, thank you. To move into this great vision of reality that enhances and courts and is beloved of people of all kinds of shapes and sizes and orientations, of all kinds of flowers of different shapes and sizes and orientations, of the insects, of the stars, of the rain, of the sun, this place within us that has the capacity to love everything. That is the visionary position, and that's what I call forth for all of us. So if you want to define yourself, if you want to define your intentions, that's a great place to be. Define your intentions as visionary and inclusive of all things. And that there may be, you can have an intention, you can have a desire, but there may be a place within you that is all-seeing, that is all-knowing, that is connected to the infinite, that is connected to multiplicity, that has a greater vision than you could even imagine at this point. That's what happened to my nephew in love, Mark. He noticed that he was defining his worth by whether or not he was working at the New York Times. And then he decided to do something different. He decided to still hold that vision, but to hold it in a detached manner. And so what he recognized then was that when he had this job over here, he was planting a seed and doing good in the world. When he had this job over here, he was planting a seed and doing good in the world. He stopped framing all of his jobs as, quote-unquote, not the New York Times. He started framing them as, I am doing something valuable in the world. And then he had this job over here, and the same thing. This is not the New York Times, and that is fine. It's almost like, you know, back to the driving metaphor, you know, if you look at the way you turn in a car, right? Do they call it a K-turn in California? I learned to drive in New York. A three-point turn, do you know what that is? Five-point turns? A Y-turn? Okay. It's like, I hope it's not a five-point turn because I'm only doing three most of the time. And, you know, you've heard about my driving skills. But so you know, in a three-point turn, let's say you're here and you're in a narrow alley and you need to go, say, that way, I can't figure it out. But but anyway, so you have to back up like this a little bit, right? And then you go forward a little bit, and then you back up again, and then you can go in the direction you want. So there's a lot of forward and back, but just because you have to back up doesn't mean that you failed. It just means that you're getting yourself into position. So these things that happen on the path to your heart's desire do not mean that you have failed. It just means perhaps that the universe is putting you into position to receive something that you wouldn't receive if you were not in that position, right? It's just moving you into a greater place of receptivity for the ultimate fulfillment of your desires and your intentions and your hopes and your dreams and that allowance of the infinite to express through you. What happened with Mark as he started recognizing that he was planting seeds and making three or so, five-point whatever turns, as he was making these turns and just recognizing that he was positioning himself for something else, was that he ended up getting a job that was not the New York Times, but he said it was the perfect job for him. And all of these jobs over here that he disdained at first, all of these jobs, all of these things that were not the New York Times either, all of these things prepared him for this incredible job that he has now, where he not only gets to write, where he not only gets to see every show on Broadway and off-Broadway and write about it, where he not only gets to do that, but he also gets to produce videos and movies and market and meet with really great people and all kinds of other stuff that just feed his soul so deeply. So he is so happy that he didn't get that job at the New York Times when he wanted it. So I think what I'm saying is that there really is something great at play in each of us. And if we can just let go of our fretting, you know, every time we fret, we are using the law in an ineffective manner. We are using it to say, yes, this is not going to happen. We are praying for what we don't want to happen, right? Ernest Holmes, Hugh pointed it out in the reading, but Ernest Holmes was very big into the word as. It is done unto you as you believe. The prayer is the demonstration itself. The thought is the demonstration itself. So as you believe this is not going to happen, in that moment, it is not happening for you. As you believe, I am just backing up for a while, gathering necessary information, that is what is happening for you as you believe it. That's the way it works. It's a very immediate thing, and all of those immediate nows create a brilliant future. So in terms of our own work, how do we apply this stuff? I think one of the things to do is certainly to be aware of our definitions. How are we letting life define us? How are we letting our intentions define us? Or are we letting our intentions define us? If this doesn't happen, will it mean that I am wrong or ruined or whatever? But a way to turn that around is to say, why do I want this thing to happen? How would I feel if this thing were to happen? And let's say if you get a job at the Times or whatever it is that you want, that you feel joyful and that you feel successful and that you feel happy and you feel like sharing your good. All of those things are available to you right now. So start doing those things. Start feeling joyful. Start feeling happy. Start sharing your good. Start feeling successful in whatever way you can right now. And then success and joy and happiness and all of that builds upon that, because success and joy and happiness and all of the spiritual qualities are not limited to form. Okay? That's one way to look at it. Another thing is when you pray or when you set intentions, you can always say this or something better. Saying, I want this thing or something better, something greater, then that allows you to, it opens up the door for trust. It's a subtle affirmation of saying, you know, I don't know everything, but I know that there is a place within me, a higher power within me that knows exactly what to do. So I'm opening up to this or something better. And one of the things that I personally do that has been very helpful is based on the work of John Patrick Shanley, who wrote Moonstruck and Doubt, two wonderful plays. And I've never met him personally, but I had a friend who had who took a seminar with him, and she said that when they were in the seminar, he made a comment that was puzzling to her. He said to the group, "When you write, you have to write better than you can. You have to write better than you can write." And she was bewildered by that. She said, "I'm already trying as hard as I possibly can." He said, "Nope. When you write, you have to write better than you can write. It doesn't make any sense to the ego, but I know that if I get up in the day and I say, on this day, I'm going to be better than I can be. On this stage, I'm going to be better than I am. In my meeting, I'm going to be more patient than I ever was before." I kind of forgot that one the other day. Just praying to be, it's actually praying to be both more and less. It's less ego and more spirit. Just praying for that, just knowing for that, shifts something, little by little, bit by bit. And then the whole world, your whole life, becomes a celebration of grace, a celebration of wholeness, a celebration of perfection, which is not perfection as the world teaches it, but the perfection that is inclusive of everything. If we do this for ourselves, if we recognize that we can be better than we are, more joyful than we are, happier than we are, more abundant than we are, more loving than we are, that shifts something deep inside of us, and we can inspire others along the same lines. And that's the energy that changes the world for good. So let us do that now. Let us turn within, and let us pray. I'm so grateful and so honored to feel this sense of the divine. Whatever it is we choose to call it, whether it's love or energy or science or that which made science or law, spirit, higher power, whatever it is, God, Buddha, whatever it is we want to call it, I just know that there is something greater and yet so personal to each of us that lives and moves and has its perfect being in every single detail of our lives. And so I honor this. I recognize this. I unify with it. And I call it my own. And I use I in the first person, but I know that it is not exclusively me. It is the I am presence. The I am presence that shows up and has its being in everything, that expresses so magnificently and so powerfully and so boldly with such grace in all of the details of our lives. And so in this moment together we step into this grace. We step into a knowing of it. No matter how much or how little we know it, it is there. And so we expand our awareness of it and know it to be possible and know it to be true. In this place, our lives are blessed and very blessed. We set powerful intentions for the good of all. We cease to define ourselves by the external world, and instead we define ourselves by the power and the presence of the living spirit within us. We practice healthy detachment. We still care what happens, but we don't force what happens, because we trust that there is an energy, a power, and a presence that knows exactly what it is doing. And we are part of that process, part of the hands and the feet of the heart of that process that evolves beauty and love and kindness into the world. And so I say this prayer for ourselves, for me, for you, for everybody sitting in this room, for the people that we hold in our hearts, and I say this prayer for all beings everywhere. May all beings be filled with peace. May all beings find happiness. May all beings feel the abundance of spirit. May all beings feel grace. May all beings be loved. I bless the transformation that is taken here today, both personally with all of us and also globally, trusting that our work makes a difference, that we are planting seeds of good in the world. We may never see the results, but these seeds are planted, and we nurture them, we nourish them, we feed them, we water them, we love them, and we trust them. I bless this teaching in all paths to God. I bless temples, churches, synagogues, mosques, ashrams, fundamentalists, atheists. I bless everyone, for everyone is playing a part in this divine comedy called planet Earth. I bless the stars and the sun and all of the forces of nature. I bless everything, for everything is a blessing. And with a heart so filled with blessedness and so filled with the divine, I say, thank you, Spirit, thank you, God. And I release these words into the divine mystery. And together we say, and so it is. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am.
There comes a time when we heed a certain call, when the world must come together as one. There are people dying, and it's time to lend a hand to life, the greatest gift of all. Shown us by turning stone to bread.